Management is essential for all organizations, big or small, profit or non-profit, services or manufacturing. Management is necessary so that individuals make their best contribution towards group objectives. Management consists of a series of interrelated functions that are performed by all managers. Later in this chapter, you will understand that although both of them are managers, they function at different levels in the organization. The time spent by managers in different functions, however, is different. Managers at the top level spend more time in planning and organizing than managers at lower levels of the organization. Concept. Management is a very popular term and has been used extensively for all types of activities and mainly for taking charge of different activities in any enterprise. As you have seen from the above example and case study, that management is an activity which is necessary wherever there is a group of people working in an organization. People in organizations are performing diverse tasks, but they are all working towards the same goal. Management aims at guiding their efforts towards achieving a common objective, a goal. Thus, management has to see that tasks are completed and goals are achieved, i.e., effectiveness, with the least amount of resources at a minimum cost, i.e., efficiency. Management has therefore been defined as a process of getting things done with the aim of achieving goals effectively and efficiently. We need to analyze this definition. There are certain terms which require elaboration. These are a process effectively and C efficiently. Process in the definition means the primary functions or activities that management performs to get things done. These functions are planning, organizing, staffing, directing and controlling, which we will discuss later in the chapter and the book. Being effective or doing work effectively basically means finishing the given task. Effectiveness in management is concerned with doing the right task, completing activities and achieving goals. In other words, it is concerned with the end result, but it is not enough to just complete the tasks. There is another aspect also, i.e., being efficient, or as we say, doing work efficiently. Efficiency means doing the task correctly and with minimum cost. There is a kind of cost-benefit analysis involved and the relationship between inputs and outputs. If by using less resources, i.e., the inputs, more benefits are derived, i.e., the outputs, then efficiency has increased. Efficiency is also increased when, for the same benefit or outputs, fewer resources are used and less costs are incurred. Input resources are money, materials, equipment and persons required to do a particular task. Obviously, management is concerned with the efficient use of these resources because they reduce costs and ultimately lead to higher profits. Effectiveness versus efficiency. These two terms are different, but they are interrelated. For management, it is important to be both effective and efficient. Effectiveness and efficiency are two sides of the same coin, but these two aspects need to be balanced, and management at times has to compromise with efficiency. For example, it is easier to be effective and ignore efficiency, i.e., complete the given task, but at a high cost. Suppose a company's target production is 5,000 units in a year. To achieve this target, the manager has to operate on double shifts due to power failure most of the time. The manager is able to produce 5,000 units, but at a higher production cost. In this case, the manager was effective but not so efficient, since for the same output, more inputs, labor cost, electricity costs, were used. At times, a business may concentrate more on producing goods with fewer resources, i.e., cutting down costs but not achieving the target production. Consequently, the goods do not reach the market and hence the demand for them declines and competitors enter the market. This is a case of being efficient but not effective, since the goods did not reach the market. Therefore, it is important for management to achieve goals effectiveness with minimum resources, i.e., as efficiently as possible, while maintaining a balance between effectiveness and efficiency. Usually, high efficiency is associated with high effectiveness. effectiveness, which is the aim of all managers, but undue emphasis on high efficiency without being effective is also not desirable. Poor management is due to both inefficiency and ineffectiveness. Characteristics of management. After going through some of the definitions, we find some elements that may be called the basic characteristics of management. Management is a goal-oriented process. An organization has a set of basic goals which are the basic reason for its existence. These should be simple and clearly stated. Different organizations have different goals. For example, the goal of a retail store may be to increase sales, but the goal of the Spastics Society of India is to impart education to children with special needs. Management unites the efforts of different individuals in the organization towards achieving these goals. 2. Management is all-pervasive. The activities involved in managing an enterprise are common to all organizations, whether economic, social, or political. A petrol pump needs to be managed as much as a hospital or a school. What managers do in India, the USA, Germany, or Japan is the same. How they do it may be quite different. This difference is due to the differences in culture, tradition, and history. 3. Management is multidimensional. Management is a complex activity that has three main dimensions. These are a management of work. All organizations exist for the performance of some work. In a factory, a product is manufactured. In a garment store, a customer's need is satisfied, and in a hospital, a patient is treated. Management translates this work in terms. The management mantra from G. Source, www.ga.co.in, of goals to be achieved, and assigns the means to achieve it. This is done in terms of problems to be solved, decisions to be made, plans to be established, budgets to be prepared, responsibilities to be assigned, and authority to be delegated. Management of people, human resources, or people are an organization's greatest asset. Despite all developments in technology, getting work done through people is still a major task for the manager. Managing people has two dimensions. It implies dealing with employees as individuals with diverse needs and behavior. 2. It also means dealing with individuals as a group of people. The task of management is to make people work towards achieving the organization's goals by making their strengths effective and their weaknesses irrelevant. See management of operations. No matter what the organization, it has some basic product or service to provide in order to survive. This requires a production process which entails the flow of input material and the technology for transforming this input into the desired output for consumption. This is interlinked with both the management of work and the management of people. If management is a continuous process, the process of management is a series of continuous, composite, but separate functions: planning, organizing, directing, staffing, and controlling. These functions are simultaneously performed by all managers all the time. You may have observed that Smita at Namki Designer Candles performs several different tasks in a single day. Some days she may spend more time in planning a future exhibition, and on another day she may spend time in sorting out an employee's problem. The task of a manager consists of an ongoing series of functions. Management is a group activity. An organization is a collection of diverse individuals with different needs. Every member of the group has a different purpose for joining the organization, but as members of the organization, they work towards fulfilling the common organizational goal. This requires teamwork and coordination of individual effort in a common direction. At the same time, management should enable all its members to grow and develop as needs and opportunities change. Management is a dynamic function. Management is a dynamic function and has to adapt itself to the changing environment. An organization interacts with its external environment, which consists of various social, economic, and political factors. In order to be successful, an organization must change itself and its goals according to the needs of the environment. You probably know that McDonald's, the fast food giant, made major changes in its menu to be able to survive in the Indian market. Management is an intangible force that cannot be seen, but its presence can be felt in the way the organization functions. The effect of management is noticeable in an organization where targets are met according to plans, employees are happy and satisfied, and there is orderliness instead of chaos. Objectives of management. Management seeks to achieve certain objectives which are the desired result of any activity. They must be derived from the basic purpose of the business. In any organization there are different objectives, and management has to achieve all objectives in an effective and efficient manner. Objectives can be classified into organizational objectives, social objectives, and personal or individual objectives. Organizational objectives. Management is responsible for setting and achieving objectives for the organization. It has to achieve a variety of objectives in all areas, considering the interest of all stakeholders, including shareholders, employees, customers, and the government. The main objective of any organization should be to utilize human and material resources to the maximum possible advantage, i.e., to fulfill the economic objectives of a business. These are survival, profit, and growth. Survival. The basic objectives of any business is survival. Management must strive to ensure the survival of the organization. In order to survive, an organization must earn enough revenues to cover costs. Profit. Mere survival is not enough for business. Management has to ensure that the organization makes a profit. Profit provides a vital incentive for the continued successful operation of the enterprise. Profit is essential for covering costs and risks of the business. Growth. A business needs to add to its prospects in the long run. For this, it is important for the business to grow, to remain in the industry. Management must exploit fully the growth potential of the organization. Growth of a business can be measured in terms of sales volume increase, in the number of employees. A quiet digital revolution is reshaping the lives of farmers in remote Indian villages. In these villages, farmers grow soybeans, wheat, and coffee in small plots of land, as they have done for thousands of years. A typical village has no reliable electricity and has antiquated telephone lines. The farmers are largely illiterate and have never seen a computer. But farmers in these villages are conducting a business through an initiative called eChupal, created by ITC, one of India's largest consumer product and agribusiness companies. ITC's eChupal initiative is a fine example of a business organization fulfilling corporate social responsibility. The basic aim of the program is to provide farmers in rural India with the opportunity to make use of a direct marketing channel, eliminating multiple intermediation and wasteful handling and unnecessary transaction costs. It is the single largest information technology-based intervention by a corporate entity in rural India, transforming the Indian farmer into a progressive, knowledge-seeking citizen, enriching him with knowledge and elevating him to a new order of empowerment. eChupal delivers real-time information and customized knowledge to improve the farmer's decision-making ability, thereby better aligning farm output to market demands, securing better quality productivity, and improved price discovery. Given the low levels of literacy in the rural sector, the role of the eChupal Sanchalak, the lead farmer of the village, in facilitating physical interface between the computer terminal and the farmers is central to the project. eChupal smart cards enable farmer identification to provide customized information on the eChupal website. Online transactions are captured to reward farmers for volume and value of usage. The eChupal initiative has found its way into the Harvard Business School as a leading case study illustrating the use of modern technology by a leading business house for the benefit of the rural poor. Source: Mohan Basoni, McCormick Tribune Professor of Technology, Kellogg School of Management, USA. The number of products or the increase in capital investment. there can be other indicators of growth. 2. Social objectives. It involves the creation of benefit for society. As a part of society, every organization, whether it is business or non-business, has a social obligation to fulfill this. IPC Empowering Rural India refers to consistently creating economic value for various constituents of society. This includes using environmental friendly methods of production, giving employment opportunities to the underprivileged sections of society, and providing basic amenities like schools and health care. For community, the box given below illustrates how a company can fulfill its social responsibility. 3. Personnel objectives. Organizations are made up of people who have different personalities, backgrounds, experiences, and objectives. They all become part of the organization to satisfy their diverse needs. These vary from financial needs such as competitive salaries and perks, social needs such as peer recognition and higher level needs such as personal growth and development. Management has to reconcile personal goals with organizational objectives for harmony in the organization. Importance of management. Having understood that management is a universal activity that is integral to any organization, we now examine some of the reasons that have made management so important. Management helps in achieving group goals. Management is required not for itself but for achieving the goals of the organization. The task of a manager is to give a common direction to the individual effort in achieving the overall goal of the organization. 2. Management increases efficiency. The aim of a manager is to reduce costs and increase productivity through better planning, organizing, directing, staffing, and controlling the activities of the organization. 3. Management creates a dynamic organization. All organizations have to function in an environment which is constantly changing. It is generally seen that individuals in an organization resist change, as it often means moving from a familiar, secure environment into a newer and more challenging one. Management helps people adapt to these changes so that the organization is able to maintain its competitive edge. If management helps in achieving personal objectives, a manager motivates and leads his team in such a manner that individual members are able to achieve personal goals while contributing to the overall organizational objective. Through motivation and leadership, the management helps individuals to develop team spirit, cooperation, and commitment to group success. Management helps in the development of society. An organization has multiple objectives to serve the purpose of the different groups that constitute it. In the process of fulfilling all these, management helps in the development of the organization, and through that it helps in the development of society. It helps to provide good quality products and services, creates employment opportunities, adopts new technology for the greater good of the people, and leads the path towards growth and development. Nature of management. Management is as old as civilization. Although modern organizations are of recent origin, organized activity has existed since the time of the ancient civilizations. In fact, organizations may be considered the distinguishing feature that separated civilized society from uncivilized ones. The earliest management practices were a set of rules and regulations that grew out of the experiences of governmental and commercial activities. The development of trade and commerce gradually led to the development of management principles and practices. The term management today has several different connotations that highlight the different aspects of its nature. The study of management has evolved over a period of time along with the modern organizations, based both on the experience and practice of managers and a set of theoretical relationships. Over a period of time, it has grown into a dynamic subject with its own special characteristics. However, one question that needs to be addressed pertaining to the nature of management is whether it is a science or an art or both. In order to answer this, let us examine the features of both science and art to see how far management fulfills them. Management is an art. What is art? Art is the skillful and personal application of existing knowledge to achieve desired results. It can be acquired through study, observation and experience. Since R is concerned with personal application of knowledge, some kind of ingenuity and creativity is required to practice the basic principles learned. The basic features of an R are as follows. I. Existence of theoretical knowledge. R presupposes the existence of certain theoretical knowledge. Experts in their respective areas have derived certain basic principles which are applicable to a particular form of R. For example, literature on dancing, public speaking, acting or music is widely recognized. 2. Personalized application. The use of this basic knowledge varies from individual to individual. Art, therefore, is a very personal under bar 01.1, 12-24 September 2019, 12:15 and 16 seconds p.m. 2021-22. Allized concept. For example, two dancers, two speakers, two actors, or two writers will always differ in demonstrating their R. 3. Based on practice and creativity, all R is practical. Art involves the creative practice of existing theoretical knowledge. We know that all music is based on seven basic notes. However, what makes the composition of a musician unique or different is his use of these notes in a creative manner that is entirely his own interpretation. Management can be said to be an R since it satisfies the following criteria. I. A successful manager practices the R of management in the day-to-day job of managing an enterprise based on study, observation and experience. There is a lot of literature available in various areas of management like marketing, finance and human resources, which the manager has to specialize in. There is existence of theoretical knowledge. 2. There are various theories of management, as propounded by many management thinkers, which prescribe certain universal principles. A manager applies these scientific methods and body of knowledge to a given situation, an issue or a problem, in his own unique manner. A good manager works through a combination of practice, creativity, imagination, initiative and innovation. A manager achieves perfection after long practice. Students of management also apply these principles differently depending on how creative they are. 3. A manager applies this acquired knowledge in a personalized and skillful manner in the light of the realities of a given situation. He is involved in the activities of the organization, studies critical situations and formulates his own theories for use in a given situation. This gives rise to different styles of management. The best managers are committed and dedicated individuals, highly trained and educated, with personal qualities such as ambition, self-motivation, creativity and imagination, a desire for development of the self and the organization. They belong to all management. Practices are based on the same set of principles. What distinguishes a successful manager from a less successful one is the ability to put these principles into practice. Management is a science. Science is a systematized body of knowledge that explains certain general truths or the operation of general laws. The basic features of science are as follows. I. Systematized body of knowledge. Science is a systematic body of knowledge. Its principles are based on a cause and effect relationship. For example, the phenomenon of an apple falling from a tree towards the ground is explained by the law of gravity. 2. Principles based on experimentation. Scientific principles are first developed through observation and then tested through repeated experimentation under controlled conditions. 3. Universal validity. Scientific principles have universal validity and application. Based on the above features, we can say that management has some characteristics of science. I. Management has a systematized body of knowledge. It has its own theory and principles that have developed over a period of time, but it also draws on other disciplines such as economics, sociology, psychology and mathematics. Like all other organized activity, management has its own vocabulary of terms and concepts. For example, all of us discuss sports like cricket and soccer using a common vocabulary. The players also use these terms to communicate with each other. Similarly, managers need to communicate with one another with the help of a common vocabulary for a better understanding of their work situation. 2. The principles of management have evolved over a period of time based on repeated experimentation and observation in different types of organizations. However, since management deals with human beings and human behavior, the outcomes of these experiments are not capable of being accurately predicted or replicated. Therefore, management can be called an inexact science. Despite these limitations, management scholars have been able to identify general principles of management. For example, scientific management principles by F.W. Taylor and functional management principles by Henri Fayol, which you will study in the next chapter. 3. Since the principles of management are not as exact as the principles of science, their application and use is not universal. They have to be modified according to a given situation. However, they provide managers with certain standardized techniques that can be used in different situations. These principles are also used for training and development of managers. You must have understood from the foregoing discussion that management has features of both art and science. The practice of management is an art. However, managers can work better if their practice is based on the principles of management. These principles constitute the science of management. Management as an art and a science are therefore not mutually exclusive, but complement each other. Management as a profession. You have understood so far that all forms of organized activity need to be managed. You would also have observed that organizations look for individuals with specific qualifications and experience to manage them. It has also been observed that there has been an increase in the corporate form of business on the one hand and increasing emphasis on managed business concerns. Does this imply that management is a profession? To answer this question, let us examine the salient features of a profession and see whether management satisfies them. A profession has the following characteristics. I. Well-defined body of knowledge. All professions are based on a well-defined body of knowledge that can be acquired through instruction. 2. Restricted entry. The entry to a profession is restricted through an examination or through acquiring an educational degree. For example, to become a chartered accountant in India, a candidate has to clear a specified examination conducted by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. 3. Professional association. All professions are affiliated to a professional association which regulates entry, grants certificate of practice and formulates and enforces a code of conduct. To be able to practice in India, lawyers have to become members of the Bar Council, which regulates and controls their activities. If ethical code of conduct, all professions are bound by a code of conduct which guides the behavior of its members. All doctors, for example, take the oath of ethical practice at the time they enter the profession. Service motive. The basic motive of a profession is to serve their clients' interests by rendering dedicated and committed service. The task of a lawyer is to ensure that his client gets justice. Management does not meet the exact criteria of a profession. However, it does have some of the features of a profession. All over the world there is marked growth in management as a discipline. It is based on a systematic body of knowledge comprising well-defined principles based on a variety of business situations. This knowledge can be acquired at different colleges and professional institutes and through a number of books and journals. The subject of management is taught at different institutions. Some of these have been set up with the specific purpose of providing management education, such as the Indian Institutes of Management, IIMS, in India. Entry to different institutes is usually through an examination. 2. There is no restriction on anyone being designated or appointed as manager in any business enterprise. Anyone can be called a manager irrespective of the educational qualifications possessed. Unlike professions such as medicine or law, which require a practicing doctor or lawyer to possess valid degrees, nowhere in the world is it mandatory for a manager to possess any such specific degree. But professional knowledge and training is considered to be a desirable qualification, since there is greater demand for those who possess degrees or diplomas from reputed institutions. Therefore, as such, the second criterion has not been strictly met. 3. There are several associations of practicing managers in India, like the AIMA All India Management Association, that has laid down a code of conduct to regulate the activities of their members. There is, however, no compulsion for managers to be members of such an association, nor does it have any statutory backing. If the basic purpose of management is to help the organization achieve its stated goal, this may be profit maximization for a business enterprise and service for a hospital. However, profit maximization as the objective of management does not hold true and is fast changing. Therefore, if an organization has a good management team that is efficient and effective, it automatically serves society by providing good quality products at reasonable prices. Levels of management. Management is a universal term used for certain functions performed by individuals in an enterprise who are bound together in a hierarchy of relationships. Every individual in the hierarchy is responsible for successful completion of a particular task. To be able to fulfill that responsibility, he is assigned a certain amount of authority or the right to take a decision. This authority-responsibility relationship binds individuals as superiors and subordinates and gives rise to different levels in an organization. Generally speaking, there are three levels in the hierarchy of an organization. I. Top management. They consist of the senior most executives of the organization by whatever name they are called. They are usually referred to as the chairman, the chief executive officer, chief operating officer, president and vice president. Top management is a team consisting of managers from different functional levels, heading finance, marketing, etc. For example, chief finance officer, vice president marketing. Their basic task is to integrate diverse elements and coordinate the activities of different departments according to the overall objectives of the organization. These top level managers are responsible for the welfare and survival of the organization. They analyze the business environment and its implications for the survival of the firm. They formulate overall organizational goals and strategies for their achievement. They are responsible for all the activities of the business and for its impact on society. The job of the top manager is complex and stressful, demanding long hours and commitment to the organization. 2. Middle management is the link between top and lower level managers. They are subordinate to top managers and superior to the first line managers. They are usually known as division heads. For example, production manager. Middle management is responsible for implementing and controlling plans and strategies developed by top management. At the same time, they are responsible for all the activities of first line managers. Their main task is to carry out the plans formulated by the top managers. For this, they need to interpret the policies framed by top management, to ensure that their department has the necessary personnel. 3. Assign necessary duties and responsibilities to them. If motivate them to achieve desired objectives and cooperate with other departments for smooth functioning of the organization. At the same time, they are responsible for all the activities of first-line managers. 3. Supervisory or operational management. Foremen and supervisors comprise the lower level in the hierarchy of the organization. Supervisors directly oversee the efforts of the workforce. Their authority and responsibility is limited according to the plans drawn by the top management. Supervisory management plays a very important role in the organization since they interact with the actual workforce and pass on instructions of the middle management to the workers. Through their efforts, quality of output is maintained, wastage of materials is minimized, and safety standards are maintained. The quality of workmanship and the quantity of output depends on the hard work, discipline, and loyalty of the workers. Functions of management. Management is described as the process of planning, organizing, directing, and controlling the efforts of organizational members and of using organizational resources to achieve specific goals. Planning is the function of determining in advance what is to be done and who is to do it. This implies setting goals in advance and developing a way of achieving them efficiently and effectively. In Smita's organization, the objective is production and sale of candles. Smita has to decide quantities, variety, and color, and then allocate resources for their purchase from different suppliers. Planning cannot prevent problems, but it can predict them and prepare contingency plans to deal with them if and when they occur. Organizing is the management function of assigning duties, grouping tasks, establishing authority, and allocating resources required to carry out a specific plan. Once a specific plan has been established for the accomplishment of an organizational goal, the organizing function examines the activities and resources required to implement the plan. It determines what activities and resources are required. It decides who will do a particular task, where it will be done, and when it will be done. Organizing involves the grouping of the required tasks into manageable departments or work units and the establishment of authority and reporting relationships within the organizational hierarchy. Proper organizational techniques help in the accomplishment of work and promote both the efficiency of operations and the effectiveness of results. Different kinds of business require different structures according to the nature of work. You will read more about this in a later chapter. Staffing, simply stated, is finding the right people for the right job. A very important aspect of management is to make sure that the right people with the right qualifications are available at the right places and times to accomplish the goals of the organization. This is also known as the human resource function, and it involves activities such as recruitment, selection, placement, and training of personnel. Emphases. Technologies which develops software needs systems analysts and programmers. Directing involves leading, influencing, and motivating employees to perform the tasks assigned to them. This requires establishing an atmosphere that encourages employees to do their best. Motivation and leadership are two key components of direction. Directing also involves communicating effectively as well as supervising employees at work. Motivating workers means simply creating an environment that makes them want to work. Leadership is influencing others to do what the leader wants them to do. A good manager directs through praise and criticism in such a way that it brings out the best in the employee. Controlling is the management function of monitoring organizational performance towards the attainment of organizational goals. The task of controlling involves establishing standards of performance, measuring current performance, comparing this with established standards, and taking corrective action where any deviation is found. Here, management must determine what activities and outputs are critical to success, how and where they can be measured, and who should have the authority to take corrective action. The various functions of a manager are usually discussed in the order given above, suggesting that a manager first plans, then organizes, puts staff in position, then directs, and finally controls. In reality, managers are rarely able to carry out these functions in isolation. The activities of a manager are interrelated, and it is often difficult to pinpoint where one ended and the other began. Coordination, the essence of management. You have understood by now that a manager has to perform five interrelated functions in the process of managing an organization, which is a system made up of different interlinked and interdependent subsystems. A manager has to link these diverse groups towards the achievement of a common goal. The process by which a manager synchronizes the activities of different departments is known as coordination. Coordination is the force that binds all the other functions of management. It is the common thread that runs through all activities, such as purchase, production, sales, and finance, to ensure continuity in the working of the organization. Coordination is sometimes considered a separate function of management. It is, however, the essence of management. For achieving harmony among individual efforts towards the accomplishment of group goals, each managerial function is an exercise contributing individually to coordination. Coordination is implicit and inherent in all functions of an organization. The process of coordinating the activities of an organization begins at the planning stage itself. TARP management plans for the entire organization. According to these plans, the organizational structure is developed and staffed in order to ensure that these plans are executed according to plans. Directing is required. Any discrepancies between actual and realized activities are then taken care of at the stage of controlling. It is through the process of coordination that a manager ensures the orderly arrangement of individual and group efforts to ensure unity of action in the realization of common objectives. Coordination, therefore, involves synchronization of the different actions or efforts of the various units of an organization. This provides the requisite amount, quality, timing, and sequence of efforts, which ensures that planned objectives are achieved with a minimum of conflict. Characteristics of coordination. The definitions given above highlight the following features of coordination. I. Coordination integrates group efforts. Coordination unifies unrelated or diverse interests into purposeful work activity. It gives a common focus to group effort to ensure that performance is as it was planned and scheduled. 2. Coordination ensures unity of action. The purpose of coordination is to secure unity of action in the realization of a common purpose. It acts as the binding force between departments and ensures that all action is aimed at achieving the goals of the organization. At Namke Designer Candles, the production and sales department have to coordinate their work so that production takes place according to the demand in the market. 3. Coordination is a continuous process. Coordination is not a one-time function, but a continuous process. It begins at the planning stage and continues till controlling. Smita plans her jewelry collection in the month of June itself. She has to then ensure that there is adequate workforce and continuously monitor whether production is proceeding according to plans. Her marketing department also has to be briefed in time to prepare their promotional and advertising campaigns. If coordination is an all-pervasive function, coordination is required at all levels of management due to the interdependent nature of activities of various departments. It integrates the efforts of different departments and different levels. The purchase, production and sales departmental efforts have to be coordinated by Smita for achieving organizational objectives harmoniously. The purchase department is responsible for procuring fabric. This then becomes the basis of the activities of the production department, and finally sales can take place. If fabric purchased is of an inferior quality or is not according to the specifications of the production department, further sales will also decline. In the absence of coordination, there is overlapping and chaos instead of harmony and integration of activities. Coordination is the responsibility of all managers. Coordination is the function of every manager in the organization. Top level managers need to coordinate with their subordinates to ensure that the overall policies for the organization are duly carried out. Middle level management coordinates with both the top level and first line managers. Operational level management coordinates the activities of its workers to ensure that work proceeds according to plans. Coordination is a deliberate function. A manager has to coordinate the efforts of different people in a conscious and deliberate manner, even where members of a department willingly cooperate and work. Coordination gives a direction to that willing spirit. Cooperation in the absence of coordination may lead to wasted effort, and coordination without cooperation may lead to dissatisfaction among employees. Coordination, therefore, is not a separate function of management, but its very essence. For an organization to effectively and efficiently achieve its objectives, coordination is required, like a thread in a garland. Coordination is a part of all management functions. Importance of coordination. Coordination is important as it integrates the efforts of individuals, departments, and specialists. The primary reason for coordination is that departments and individuals in the organization are interdependent, i.e., they depend on each other for information and resources to perform their respective activities. Thus, managers need to reconcile differences in approach, timing, effort, or interest. At the same time, there is a need to harmonize individual goals and organizational goals. Growth in size. As organizations grow in size, the number of people employed by the organization also increases. At times, it may become difficult to integrate their efforts and activities. All individuals differ in their habits of work, background, approaches to situations, and relationships with others. It becomes necessary to ensure that all individuals work towards the common goals of the organization, but employees may have their own individual goals also. Therefore, for organizational efficiency, it is important to harmonize individual goals and organizational goals through coordination. 2. Functional differentiation. Functions of an organization are divided into departments, divisions. The Dabur Wallace of Mumbai is the story of a Six Sigma business enterprise. The success of the business lies in the complex, yet well-coordinated exercise that is carried out on the streets of Mumbai day after day. What is the secret behind the efficiency with which their business is conducted? The story of the Dabur Wallace begins in the kitchens of Mumbai. After they step out of their door, someone begins the time-consuming process of preparing the worker a fresh, home-cooked lunch. What happens next for demonstrates the coordination of the Dabur Wallace system. The first Dabur Ula picks up the tiffin from home and takes it to the nearest railway station. The second Dabur Ula sorts out the dabbers at the railway station according to destination and puts them in the luggage carriage. The third one travels with the dabbers to the railway stations nearest to the destinations. The fourth one picks up dabbers from the railway station and drops them off at the offices. By mid-morning, thousands of Dabur Wallace are bicycling through the streets of Mumbai, ensuring a hot home cooked lunch for their customers. The whole tiffin distribution requires negligible technology. The Dabur Wallace rely on low capital and use cycles, wooden carriages, and local trains to achieve their target. There are several groups that work independently and network with each other to achieve their goal. Each area is divided into several small distribution sectors, and each sector is handled by a particular person. This person understands the address in that locality very well. Also, this perfection comes with practice. Many new employees work for months under the guidance of their seniors. Punctuality and time management are on top of the agenda for Dabur Wallace. Whatever be the circumstances, the Dabur Wallace never get delayed even by a few minutes. Dabur Wallace excellence through coordination. Chandabar 01.9242. Ashen are interdependent. Coordination is balancing and keeping together the team by ensuring suitable allocation of tasks to the various members and seeing that the tasks are performed with harmony among the members themselves. EFL Breck. Coordination is the process whereby an executive develops an orderly pattern of group efforts among his subordinates and secures unity of action in the pursuit of common Purpose, McFarland. Coordination is the orderly synchronizing of efforts of subordinates to provide proper amount, timing and quality of execution so that their united efforts lead to the stated objectives, namely, the common purpose of the enterprise and sections. In an organization, there may be separate departments of finance, production, marketing, or human resources. All these departments may have their own objectives, policies, and their own style of working. For example, the marketing department's objective may be to increase sales by 10% by offering discounts, but the finance department may not approve of such discounts as it means loss of revenue. These kinds of conflict arise in organizations because each unit/department is performing activities in isolation from others and barriers between departments are becoming more rigid. However, all departments and individuals are interdependent, and they have to depend on each other for information to perform their activities. The activity of each department needs to be focused on attainment of common organizational goals. The process of linking the activities of various departments is accomplished by coordination. 3. Specialization. Modern organizations are characterized by a high degree of specialization. Specialization arises out of the complexities of modern technology and the diversity of tasks to be performed. Organizations, therefore, need to employ a number of specialists. Specialists usually think that they only are qualified to evaluate, judge, and decide according to their professional criteria. They do not take advice or suggestions from others in matters pertaining to their area of specialization. This often leads to conflict amongst different specialists as well as others in the organization. Therefore, some coordination is required by an independent person to reconcile the differences in approach, interest, or opinion of the specialists. Management in the 21st century. Even as you read this chapter, the organization and its management are changing as boundaries between cultures and nations get blurred and new communication technology makes it possible to think of the world as a global village. The scope of international and intercultural relationships is rapidly expanding. The modern organization is a global organization that has to be managed in a global perspective. What does this imply? Concept. Management is the process of planning, organizing, staffing, directing and controlling the enterprise resources efficiently and effectively for achieving the goals of the organization. Effectiveness in management is concerned with doing the right task, completing activities and achieving goals. Efficiency means doing the task correctly and with minimum cost. Characteristics. The key features of management are I. Goal-oriented process. 2. All-pervasive. 3. Multidimensional. IV. Continuous process. Group activity. VI. Dynamic function. V. Tangible force. Objectives. Management fulfills 3 basic objectives: organizational, social, and personal importance. Management is important because it helps in achieving group goals, increases efficiency, creates a dynamic organization, helps achieve personal objectives, and contributes to the development of society. Nature. Management is a combination of an organized body of knowledge, science, and its skillful application are, although it does not satisfy all the requirements of a profession, it is to a large extent professional in character. Levels. Management is considered a 3-tier activity. The top management focuses on determination of objectives and policies. Middle management attempts to achieve these objectives through the effort of other managers and supervisory or operational management directly oversees the efforts of the workforce. Functions. All managers perform the following interrelated functions: planning, organizing, staffing, directing and controlling. Coordination. Coordination is the essence of management. It is the process of achieving unity of action among interdependent activities and departments of an organization.